Welcome to the milk bar. 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 Welcome to the milk bar.
Welcome along to episode 555 of the Milk Bar. Jason Forrest here with you as ever. And coming up on the show, we'll be finding out about the Bags of Laughter show, raising funds for charity with Hugh Dennis as its MC. That's taking place next week at the Crescent Theatre in Birmingham. We'll be having a chat with Martin Kemp all about what to do with your inheritance, because the older generation are leaving it expecting the kids to have a bit of fun, maybe go on holiday. But they're investing it. We'll be finding out more about that one. Suzie Dent joins us along with a team from Sir Link a Lot to talk about ways of getting your kids to learn to spell. We will be finding out about the Luncheon Club, which takes place in Fallings Park, and your chance if you are one of our older members of the community to go along and have some great social time over there. On top of that, we'll be finding out how you can vote in the Whitmarine's Unsung Hero nominations. That's all coming up in the next few weeks. Closing date, the 24th of February, to get your nominations in. So we'll tell you about that one when we have a chat with one of our local councillors and the sponsors behind one of the awards. We've got some great music on the way too. But first of all, on August the 27th at the Dumston Mill Theatre, Millbank in Dudley, Be My Love is on stage. It's a tribute to Mario Lanza. To tell us more, I'm joined now by Tara Marisa Kelsey. Hello.
Hello there, Jason.
So you've got an amazing night lined up here, and you are pulling all of this together as well as performing on the night yourself.
That's right, yes. I'm totally organising the whole event myself.
Now, so this involves a bit of travel to make sure that all things come together, because you're actually heading out to Italy for a bit of a rehearsal with your main man on the night.
I've recently been out there for a trip. Mm-hmm. We collaborate. It's very exciting. So we are collaborating the music. Mm-hmm. Together, and Simone Francesco Leconti, as our Italian tenor is called, he's very excited to be coming to the UK. It will be his UK debut, and he's a professional touring Italian tenor, so his singing career takes him performing all over Europe and as far as Asia, and he takes the beautiful big romantic leads, tenor leads. So yeah, it's very exciting.
And the music of Mario Lanza is so well suited to this sort of performance. And as you say, a debut for him in the UK, but really probably the first time in at least a very good many years we've heard anything like this in our area.
Oh, most definitely. And this is what I'm so excited about, Jason, because Mario Lanza, he brought opera to the people. Mm-hmm. through his movies. He made several movies in his brief career, because, of course, he was only tragically passed at 38. Mm-hmm. So it was a very, very brief, but amazing, beautiful, big career that he had, that just made such an impression. Yeah,
so iconic as well, and I think that's the thing.
Very.
And even when it comes down to things like, I grew up listening to the Mario Lanza Christmas album, that sort of thing, and so much other pieces of his work that really have stood the test of time, because it's been quite a while since we lost him.
Yes, it has 1959. Mm-hmm. He died. So yes, and it would have been his 99th birthday on the 31st of January gone. Mm-hmm. So but you know, the his music, his recordings, it's just totally stood the test of time. And I've had so many people already that have heard about this event share beautiful stories of their childhood memories of watching his films and listening to him, you know. It really is wonderful. Mm-hmm. So and Mario Lanza, as I say, he brought Italian opera to the people, and it's something that unless you go to Covent Garden in London, you never get a taste of. You know, it was kind of always for the elite, wasn't it? You know, and he brought it to the people, and this is what I'm so excited about, because as you say, here in the Midlands, there's been nothing like this. So for us to be having Simone come over and present us with Italian opera in the true Mario Lanza style is just, it's fantastic. And of course, I will perform alongside him, doing many of Mario's ballads, because of course he was known for the, he was the ultimate crossover artist, because there was all his popular ballads from the musicals like The Toast from New Orleans that he did. These all ring some bells for people. The Seven Hills of Rome, The Student Prince, and of course the great Caruso, where he played his idol. So absolutely, it's very exciting, and it's been a dream.
Mario Lanza made this music accessible in a way in which, you know, it would have been difficult to imagine at the time. It's like you mentioned crossover artists. It wasn't even thought of that in that way. People were performing music that they loved, and you know, Mario Lanza's amazing vocal range, which Simone is going to recreate on stage here, is just going to absolutely wow the audience.
Yeah, they will be absolutely blown away. It will be so wonderful.
And you've got a fantastic pianist working with you on the night as well.
Oh my goodness, yes. We are so lucky. Wayne C. Baddeley is our pianist, and I've worked alongside him doing other concert work now for the last 3 years. But Wayne he's an amazing solo artist in his own right, and he's toured all over the world on the big American cruise ships. He's played with the Joe Loss Orchestra. He's performed on the BBC and with many celebrities, and he will also be doing some amazing solo piano on the night as well, because he is a true artist and performer in his own right as well. So yes, amazing. We're so lucky. We're so lucky to have Wayne as well.
Well, the Dormston Mill Theatre is just an utterly fantastic venue. It is going to suit this evening so well. Doors are at 7 o'clock. The event starts at 7:30. Tickets are priced at £18.50. You can get those online at ct.co.uk/bemylove, or you can call the box office for this event on 07957 661 222. That's 07957 661 222. It is Be My Love, a tribute to Mario Lanza. And to set the scene, we're going to hear some of the work of Simone now, aren't we? What are we going to take a listen to?
Oh, it's a wonderful Neapolitan song called Coriangrato. That translates as ungrateful heart. And Mario Lanza actually performed this in his film The Toast of New Orleans. And this will be in the program on the night. So yes, this will give everyone a taste of what they can look forward to.
Well, we look forward to them feasting on the music in this tribute to Mario Lanza, Be My Love. As I say, it is the 27th of August this year. It's priced at £18.50. ct.co.uk/bemylove or 07957 661 222. For now, Tara and Marissa Kelsey, thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me, Jason. It's been a pleasure. Thank you. Stupa rota me, no spasa me.
On Friday the 20th of March, Whitmore Reans will be paying tribute to its unsung heroes. Closing date for entries on the voting for that are on the 24th of February. To tell us more, I'm joined now by Abeda Ahmed and Steve Downs. Hello to you both.
Good evening.
Right, so Abeda, first of all, you are a councillor for the area?
I am. I'm one of the St Peter's councillors.
And you must be really proud of some of the people in your area, and you're really pleased that they're actually going to be recognised in this way.
Yeah, so I'm one of the newer councillors here. I became a councillor back in 2018, so about 18 months ago. And one of the things that really stood out for me was how many people in Whitmore Reans give up so much of their own time and their own resources just to make the place better for everyone.
Mm-hmm. And it's a warm, friendly community, yeah. And it's pleasantly diverse as well, which is nice. Mm-hmm. And yeah, it's when you've got things like the Avion Centre and all the different meeting points there, and there, Gattis and yeah, the Wild Side, as well as all the other things that are happening. It is just such a fantastic community spirit, and it's an area which has probably been undervalued in the past.
It has, and there's a lot of people who have been there for a very long time. They've made it their home, mm-hmm. and they just look after it for the sake of looking after it. And I think I was really taken back by that. I've lived in Whitmore Reans all my life,
yeah.
Still live there. It's a great place to be. Like you said, there's so much diversity, so much to enjoy, and it's easy to focus on the bad side. But if you look, there's actually quite a lot to celebrate there,
mm-hmm.
and this is what this event is about.
Yeah, so there's quite a large number of awards going to be handed out on this this evening, and there's going to be sponsors for each of those. One of those is the Wildside Activity Centre. So tell us a bit about your award to start off with.
Right, okay. So we're working with Gattis Community Space. So Wildside and Gattis are doing two Eco Champion Awards, doing a junior one for under 16s and an adult one. So we're looking for people who are passionate about the environment, go out and look after the green spaces and maybe do litter picks, that type of thing. So we're looking for people to nominate their eco champions.
And when you're looking at these awards, this is one of the few ones that are actually for youngsters. Most of these will be aimed at the adult proportion of the community. So it's great that you guys, as you're open to kids through the schools projects that you run, and also the adults who use the place at the weekends and sometimes during the week, you know, you are fully accessible to the whole community, aren't you?
Absolutely, yeah. Both ourselves and Gattis wanted to do something for young people because we feel there's a gap really for young people in Whitmore Reans, and we want to get people captivated at an early age, I guess, so mm-hmm. that they get involved and mm-hmm. take an active part in the society in which they live.
Yeah, and the good bit is we do see that, and I'm sure already you've got some names in mind you're hoping to see nominated,
yeah.
that will then move forward to the potential consideration for an award.
Yeah.
And each of these awards has a gift assigned to it as well, so you know it isn't just a certificate they're getting, they'll get a little treat too.
That's right, yeah. Different organisations are putting up prizes of between £30 and £50, which will be awarded on the night at to the Wolverhampton Heritage Centre.
Mm-hmm. So that's going to be a great venue, and you must be really pleased that it's going to be a good place and a suitable fitting ceremony for the award winners.
Definitely. I think it has to be somewhere where in Whitmore Reans where people can access easily, and which is recognised really by everyone.
Mm-hmm.
I was going to say about the young children, there is some awards for a bright future,
mm-hmm.
as well as the eco one, isn't there?
Looking one from the library.
And there's one from the Gloucester Street Community Church.
Yeah.
Future Talent Award. There's a range.
Mm-hmm.
We want some people all over there.
Yeah, but it's the whole community who can get involved
exactly,
in this.
Exactly, yeah.
And, I mean, what are the criteria that you're looking for, Steve? I mean, is it going to be somebody who's maybe led a group or tried to book your centre for an event? Or what sort of thing would
Not
you expect?
Not necessarily. I mean, we're open to... We will look at each nomination carefully and...
Mm-hmm.
Maria from Gattis and myself will then decide who we think is the most deserving winner. So we haven't set any criteria in mind yet, so yeah.
So we don't know yet, but we will find out on the night. And this is going to be the good part of it. Again, a lot of the community coming together to share in an evening of chat and a buffet and getting a chance to sit down and have a bit of a natter.
Yeah, and I think that's what it's about, isn't it? Celebrating all of us in Whitmore Reans and celebrating what's good about Whitmore Reans. And it's a great opportunity. I just really hope everyone comes forward and nominates the ones that you've gone by all these years and without having any recognition.
Because they just do something and it becomes natural that they are the ones doing it in the community.
It's taken for granted almost, isn't it? And I think this is a great opportunity just to say thank you to them.
Mm-hmm. And you've got the Walls Foundation involved as well, so they'll be putting another big name up there on those who are contributing towards the awards on the night. And any others that stand out for you?
There's an award from TLC College, there's Gloucester Street Community Church, Whitmore Reans Connect, I believe.
Yeah,
and I think
the New Hampton Arts Centre have put an award in as well.
Yeah, there's quite a few little
and
groups.
Wolverhampton Homes, I believe, and Midland Heart. So people from across the area will be recognised for different aspects of what they do.
Mm-hmm. And there is a full list on the website as well, isn't there? So people can check out what's going on.
Yeah, and you can nominate through the website as well.
Mm-hmm. So that has to be done by Sunday the 24th of February. So time is running out. Make sure you get this done. What's the website?
It's wolverhampton.gov.uk/unsungheroes.
And you can also nip along to the library in Whitmore Reans, not only to go online and put your entries in that way, but also you can pick up a paper copy of the form if you wish to. And many of the community languages that are spoken throughout, you can chat with somebody at the library who can help you out and fill the form in if maybe English isn't your first language and you're not feeling too comfortable.
Yes, you can. There's opportunity to do that. Or you can contact us through the Facebook page as well, through Wolverhampton Today. One of the councillors or one of the council team will happily accommodate.
Make sure to... The important thing is everybody gets to vote. It is completely open and you can look at all the nomination categories on there and really see who you know that fits into those categories. And I don't think it's been too difficult to think of people who will fall into all of them, having read through the list myself.
No.
It's going to be an interesting one. So we're all looking forward to the event. I'm going to be there on the night as well. So looking forward to hosting for the whole night. And say lots of awards to announce, and I think we're all really proud of what the community in Whitmore Reans are doing. Yeah. So give us that website again.
So it's wolverhampton.gov.uk/unsungheroes.
And Steve, if people want to come out and check out what you're doing down at the Wild Side, where do we find you?
If you have a look on our website, it's wildsideac.co.uk, or have a look on our Facebook page. We've got loads of stuff coming on, particularly over the holiday for young people.
So check it all out and get involved. That's the important thing.
Yes,
and more importantly, if you're not somebody who normally leads because you're being led by someone else, get involved and take the lead on voting for that person who normally organises events for you.
Exactly.
It's a way to do it.
Forward to it.
Yeah, it's going to be absolutely brilliant. Make sure you're voting for your Whitmore Reans Unsung Heroes.
Time for another tune now, this time from Christopher Taylor. This is My Angel.
I feel I'm home, safe and loved where I belong. You are my light, my reason why. You are the beat behind my song. I'd loved before we met, like ghosts upon a breeze. Faded, fleeting, all true form, and faltered to deceive. You make me better, stronger, more. You raise my hopes and sights to levels I could never reach, to ever increasing heights when I see you. You make me feel so alive when I'm with you. We can do most anything together. We can fly.
sleep at night. Blessings counted, balance checked. I think of you and you and I, and how we do connect. You make me better, stronger, more. You raise my hopes and sights to levels I could never reach, to ever increasing heights when I see you. So alive when I'm with you. We can do most anything together. We can fly so high.
Taylor with My Angel here on the Milk Bar. On the 21st of February, Baby Lifeline are having their Bags of Laughter show. It is taking place at the Crescent in Birmingham, and I'm joined on the line now by founder and CEO of Baby Lifeline, Judy Ledger. Good afternoon.
Hi, hi.
How are we doing?
Very well, thank you. Getting excited about the event already.
I can imagine. I mean, we're a couple of weeks away, but it is going to be an absolutely brilliant night of comedy and some amazing names down there, including your host, Hugh Dennis.
Yeah, he's a fantastic guy. He offered to host. He said, you know, we've got some fantastic acts on. I would rather host. So we're very happy about that.
And I mean, what can we expect on the night? Because it is going to be fast-paced, good fun throughout.
Very much so, a really packed show. As you say, very, very well-known names. We have tickets, standard tickets, flying out the door as we speak. We have a few less for the VIPs. We have a few celebrities in the audience. And basically, you'll have a buffet reception and drinks and VIP seats and meet some of the cast, well, the comedians after the show. So, you know, we're just preparing for the countdown right now.
So this is going to be, as we say, a big night. General admission is priced at £40, VIP at £110. And all of that is packaged together to create the sort of funding you need for Baby Lifeline. And tell us a bit about this and how the charity first came about.
Well, I feel rather old, but it started and we are on the countdown to our 40th birthday. I can't believe it. I was a young nurse. I became pregnant, got to about 6 months, 24 weeks pregnant, and sadly had, you know, a fairly traumatic labour and lost a little girl during the birth. Mm-hmm. I then went on to have a second pregnancy, another little girl who was born prematurely again and died after a day. And then, unbelievably, got pregnant again, had a little boy at 28 weeks who didn't survive either. He lived for a day. As a nurse, well, I was devastated, you know, about everything. But as a nurse, I got together with some of the colleagues and we thought, well, you know, we'd just say thank you to everyone. I was told I'd never have any children. It would be impossible. They didn't quite know what had happened. And that's how it all started in Coventry. Went across the Midlands. And 40 years later, we've raised millions. We train midwives, obstetricians, GPs, paramedics, anaesthetists, all over. We train about 3,000 a year now, but we buy equipment for units. Wolverhampton and the Midlands areas have known us for many, many years. But the basic aim is to support the care of all pregnant women and newborn babies, giving them the best start in life. And it's just gone from there, really. I now have three children, and my kids go, why don't you tell them? My daughter actually works with me. She's a very clever girl. Mm-hmm. Didn't have a great time, but had fantastic care, and that's what it's all about, really.
Obviously, a difficult time for you in your early life. Yeah, three kids now, but yeah, with those who sadly didn't make it through those early days, I mean, you have been through the worst any parent can be through and have come out stronger on the other yeah. side, and are doing this work to help others to make sure that everyone does get that best start in life.
Yes, absolutely. I think of them as a legacy. I still think about them. I'm actually a grandma as well to little Artie and Poppy, and about to have another grandchild in about 3 weeks' time. So all, you know, good things happen.
But still, they are part of your family and always will be, even though they can't be there with you. And, you know, it's part of their legacy, the Baby Lifeline charity and all the great work that you've done. And have you seen a change in the way in which children who are born prematurely are being treated in that time? Because I remember things like Blue Peter appeals in the past for extra yeah. baby care units. And this was in my lifetime, and I'm just approaching 48. So, you know, this all stems yeah. around the same sort of time as you were unfortunately having those troubles in your life.
Yes, I've seen huge changes. I mean, actually, the charity isn't just about prematurity. It's about every pregnant mother and baby and looking after them to ensure the best possible outcome. So not only when things go wrong, but to give them the best care. There have been cases highlighted, as everyone knows, on the news where things have, very tragic things have happened. I have to say that's a small minority. Today, I think, you know, in this country, we have fantastic care, access to great care, and our professionals are very dedicated and caring. So I've seen massive changes since I lost mine, and indeed, I've got the three children as a result. So we're looking at helping everyone and looking at a healthy generation to go forward.
So funding here is going to go towards delivery bags as well as everything else. So tell us a bit about those.
Yeah, that was a project that we train paramedics and midwives together about coping with emergencies in the community. Paramedics, we love paramedics, obviously. You know, mm-hmm. they go to all sorts of crises, but one of the things that they get particularly nervous about is when things happen, because they don't happen very often, but when they do in the community and they have to act fast. And they get something like half a day in their normal training, their general training. So anyway, we've got this course, and a lot of the midwives were talking to them about their bags and what they carry. But the midwives hadn't really got any standardized bag content. Mm-hmm. Some of them carried plastic bags. There were bits and pieces. So we decided, and it took 2 years, to get an expert team together and produce bags within a sort of paramedic bag, everything that you should need for a home delivery, whether it's normal or whether there's a problem. And they're going all over the country right now. Very, very proud of that. So that's why we sort of thought, well, some of the money will go to this project, and we'll call it Bags of Laughter. And we had Call the Midwife Stars launch it with us, with the midwives. Fantastic.
Brilliant stuff. Well, so it's going to be a huge night of comedy. Bags of Laughter is the event. Hugh Dennis is hosting Friday the 21st of February. It is at the Crescent Theatre. That's on Sheepcote Street in Brindley Place, Birmingham. Tickets from crescent-theatre.co.uk or by calling the box office on 0121 643 5848. Don't forget, those VIP tickets are available at £110. Standard entry is at £40. And on the night, you've got some fantastic special guests. Joe Enright, Hardy Singh Coley, Becky Brunning, you got Arthur Smith down there, Simon Brodkin, Shapiko Sandy and Jeff Whiting. So an absolutely fantastic lineup as well.
Thank you. It will be fantastic.
It's going to be a brilliant night. Have a brilliant time down there, and we look forward to hearing more about the event when it's all happened. But give us the details of the charity as well, so people can actually get involved, see what you're doing, and also if they want to donate, a sneaky donation would be appreciated, wouldn't it?
Oh, that we certainly would. Every penny counts. The website is www.babylifeline.org.uk. The telephone number is 01676 534 71.
And if they wanted to do a sponsored event or something to raise funds, and whether it's somebody who knows they've been helped by the charity, or somebody who doesn't realise that they've been helped by the charity because it's all gone in the background with the NHS crew that they've seen, then, you know, do something, make a difference, and help bring somebody into the world in as calm a way as possible, even though there will be screaming children at some point.
Thank you.
Judy Ledger of Baby Lifeline, thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Another song for you now. This time we're taking the first of the two tracks on the double A side by Angela Lewis Brown. You Do Something to Me.
You do something to me. Something deep inside. I'm hanging on the wire. The love I'll never find. You'll do something wonderful, chase it all away, mixing my emotions. Catch a flame to feel real again.
Angela Lewis Brown with You Do Something to Me here on The Milk Bar. More from her very soon. Around 81% of all adults, rising to 86% of parents, believe the nation's ability to spell everyday words is deteriorating, with 63% blaming our inability to spell correctly on over-reliance on autocorrect. Now, autocorrect seems to be the bane of my life because it's never entirely sure what I'm trying to say. Somebody who might be able to understand us a little better is Suzie Dent, you'll of course know from Countdown's Dictionary Corner, and a founder of Sir Linkalot, who's got a great way of training kids in spelling. Andy Salmon, good afternoon to you both.
Hello.
Right,
so first of all, tell us a bit about this side of the survey whereby we know that kids are finding it difficult to spell. I know I did as a kid. I got round that by having atrocious handwriting so no one could tell whether I spelt it right or wrong.
You should become a doctor.
If only I wouldn't be sat here now, I'd be earning more money.
The spelling for sure, the last 10, 15 years, there's no doubt. I do school presentations, been to 500 schools, and there's no question that children read less now for pleasure. There's no doubt about that, no doubt at all. And of course, when you've got entertainment at the end of your hands with gadgets, why would you read for pleasure, particularly if you find spelling tricky? Why would you do it? And so people read less now, therefore, with reading, it's like rote learning. You keep seeing the same word in the correct context all the time. There's more chance you'll be able to spell correctly. There's less of that. There's predictive text, of course, and there's spell check as well. But, of course, children don't have predictive text and spell check in school. Obviously, in their gadgets, they do. So when you've got that, you're sort of getting away with it. I think spell check is wonderful because it means the people who struggle with spelling can communicate. It's fantastic.
But hopefully they might learn from that when they see the autocorrect and spell checker. But that sounds like it's not necessarily the case with kids. I mean, and when it comes to reading as well, I mean, Suzie, one word that it can be quite difficult, I suppose, is misled, because it looks like mizzled when it's written down. So it's things like that that must be an issue.
Absolutely. And in fact, it's funny you mentioned misled, because we call those words which are actually quite difficult in your head to split, because they used to have hyphens. They're called mizzles for that very reason, because of misled. But, you know, it's interesting with spell checkers, because, yes, we are over-reliant on them, but actually you have to be pretty good at spelling to use them properly. They can lead you astray very, very quickly. They lead me astray sometimes. You know, they replace things that I actually don't want and don't need. So you have to be really, really careful. And good spelling is important, not because, 200 years ago somebody introduced a Latin rule that you had to abide by. It's important because you want to be articulate and you want to get your message across. And anybody, when they're writing something, wants the message to be heard. And if there's a poor spelling in there or a wrong spelling, then the reader's going to trip up over that and your message is gone. That's why it's important. It's all about clarity of communication.
Because I tend to find myself sometimes, I can't spell a word, I think of another one in its place. But it's having a wide enough vocabulary to be able to do that that can sometimes also be a bit limiting too.
Yes, and it's all about confidence, actually. Just, you know, you should just kind of go for it. And then, you know, if you know exactly which ones you find as your pitfalls, I was talking off air earlier about just having to stop and look at aneurysm, because I wasn't completely sure how to spell aneurysm, and it took me about a good 5 seconds, but I had to use it. But you know, you've got your dictionary there, you've got the Sir Linkalot app there, you can come up with your target list of things you need to spell and bob your uncle, as they say.
I suppose if the words, the letters were in the wrong order, you'd have had a much better chance of spelling the word. However, that's just what you get to do on TV. But so with this Sir Linkalot app, Andy, how does this work to get kids to understand the spelling of these tricky words a lot more easily?
It's attacked words from like was and they and are, I mean, what a ridiculous word that is. Car, far, jar and bar. There's no E. R-E. Well, what are you doing? And no one has attacked these tricky words, even for tiny words for children at that age. They're not phonetic. Mm-hmm. So I've sort of called it after phonics comes mnemonics. It's attacked all these tricky words in bundles of 20, 20 words in each bundle. There's a test in each bundle as well. The child looks at one or two a day. They're 10, 15-second animations bringing the word to life. If you find spelling tricky, like the word a biscuit, for example, it's a classic, you look at that word and think, well, what is that you doing? I'm going to say that you. I'm not having it. I'm going to say it. So, well, no, you can't. Well, why not? And you say, look, there's a cup in the biscuit. They say, what are you talking about? The C is the handle. The U is the cup. They see the physical cup and lick and coffee going into it. Oh, my goodness. There is a cup in the biscuit. So it's break. Children get frightened of spelling, like the word accommodate, how many C's and M's, and recommend and and embarrassed. What do we do with these double letters? I don't know what to do. And Selinkala is attacking these words head on and having a fun, like embarrassed, for example, okay? It's got two R's, because when you get embarrassed, you have two red cheeks, not one red cheek. The two R's are the two red cheeks. So it's got the meaning of the word as well. So each bundle, and you start at your level, you start level one up to level five. You do one or two a day, and your confidence kicks in within seconds. 90% of children who think they can't do it, Jason, it's confidence. It's yep. all it is, I promise you. And children who find learning tricky, my goodness, it's a massive shot in the arm. And they're different people the next day, even minutes later.
It's certainly like telling a story. And with the mnemonics, they actually go, and what's your mnemonic for mnemonics? Because I can't spell that, I can barely say it.
Well, okay, that's a good one. You know amnesia? Amnesia.
Mm.
Yeah, as in you can't remember something.
Yeah.
A is like a prefix, like typical, atypical, the A at the start. Amnesia, you can spell, agreed? Amnesia.
Yep.
A-M-N-E-S-I-A. Do you agree you can spell that?
I probably could spell that, yeah. At a push, okay, I would take be
Take off
brave.
The A. Take off the A.
Yep.
Amnesia is the loss of memory. The opposite, take off the A, is memory. M-N-E of amnesia, which you know is at the start of the word mnemonic.
Okay. I will...
It's a memory aid. It's a bit of work, but you suddenly get where the word amnesia comes from. And where Susie's coming to play here is the reason why she likes the app is because she wants to tell children about the story of words. And there's some wonderful stories out there, but getting their attention is very, very tricky, especially if they can't spell the word. Like biscuit, the cup of the biscuit. Right, over to you, Susie. She then explains what the origin of this word is. Do you know, Jason, by any chance, the origin of the word biscuit?
I just know that when it comes to cups and biscuits, mine tend to be biscuits in cups with the cup of tea dunking them. So I think I need a better understanding here, Susie.
Okay, Susie, the origin of that word biscuit?
Origin of the word biscuit is the B-I that you get in bicycle. Bicycle means two wheels, bicycle. And the B-I in biscuit means twice as well. It comes from the French twice cooked, because when the French first started making biscuits, they would cook them once, and then they'd cook them again in a slow oven.
So cuit is the past tense of the verb cook in French, like cuisine.
Ah.
So it's twice cooked. But if you said to a child, do you want the story of a word you can't spell? No, don't insult me. Don't rub it in, all right? Once you've got biscuit, the spelling, oh, I've got you. Over to Susie. And this is where this whole thing works. And my character is to link a lot, because I like to link a lot. And Susie is called Susie Lexicographer. Lexicography is lexicon is words. Dyslexia is the fear of words. So we're a team together, helping children, saying that words are fun. It's getting the child's attention is so, so difficult. When their attention span every year gets shorter and shorter, a 10, 15-second clip, they're in.
And actually, the results with people who do have dyslexia, Jason, have been amazing, both children and adults.
Mm-hmm.
It's ridiculous. Yeah,
when it comes to adults as well, then, if we wanted a word that could impress in meetings that we also need to be able to spell right, we might struggle with, Susie, what could you come up with?
What do you want to say in your meeting?
Oh, we could just be trying to be a bit verbose and showy offy at the start.
Okay, well, I've got one. Do you mind if I've got one?
No, go for it.
Okay, manoeuvre, okay? You said that was a nice manoeuvre by Boris Johnson there or something. Manoeuvre is a killer word. Can I put you on the spot, Jason? Is that okay?
Go on.
Can you spell manoeuvre?
I think we've got an M, an A, and an N, an O, a U, a V, or an R, and an E.
That's a countdown combi. It's all there.
Yeah.
It's like Eric Morecambe, not necessarily in the right order.
Wait, just missed out an E.
Yes, it's very good. But the trick is, I mean, it's. I did this trick with children. I think it's very clever, but they're not going to remember it. But they do. It's ridiculous what children can learn. I cannot believe what they can soak up. And it's the word man followed by our, O-U-R, and Eve, alternate letters. So a man does a manoeuvre down our chimneys every Christmas Eve. It's our and Eve, alternate letters. So it's O-E-U-V-R-E. I thought that's very clever, but they're not going to get it. They get it. And a month later, they still get it. So that's the word to show off to your in your meeting. Spell manoeuvre, and you say our Eve. It's a bit of work, but children, so I say, look, if you're spelling manoeuvre, your parents can't spell it. Don't tell me you can't spell. All right. And they say, well, how can I argue?
Also, I'm going to throw one in here. It's fairly easy to spell, I guess, because straight from Latin. But if there's somebody who bangs on in your meeting about something that they know absolutely nothing about, they are an ultra-crepidarian. Ultra-crepidarian. There's a lovely story behind it. But, yeah, that's somebody who loves to pontificate on subjects they know zero about. There's a long story about a Greek painter and a cobbler who dared to criticise not just the shoe on the painting, but also the leg. And ultra-crepidarian means beyond the shoe or beyond the sole. So basically what the painter was saying is, don't you dare criticise beyond the shoe because you know nothing about anything else.
Great, I didn't know that.
And is this second, yes?
Did you know the 12 months in the calendar? Did you know your name is in there? You must have known that.
It appears from July, August, September, October, and November.
That's right. You must. I just think I should didn't know it, but you did, which is fine.
I do.
I'm looking for links all the time.
They're there constantly, and this is a great way of learning. And through this app, if the school actually buys this, the parents can use it too.
For free, hey. Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. They can buy it from the app store, or if they wait for the school to buy it, they get free access. This goes to any child. English is a second language. Oh my goodness, it's so strong for that as well. It works. It works around the world to learn English, for sure. And the parents say it's free access at home, any gadget.
Well, absolutely fantastic stuff. A great way of... And I think if we'd have had apps when I was a kid, because I'm getting old now, we barely had a computer. We had a BBC Model B. But if we'd had this sort of stuff to be able to play with and use at school, it would have made a massive difference, certainly to me, as stories were being told. Because it
you
is that sort of thing.
Can
still
use it, Jason.
I think I need to, judging by my poor spelling manoeuvre. But so we're looking for Salinkalot in the App Store, are we?
That's right, yeah, and salinkalot.org is the website.
Smashing. Andy Salmon, thank you for joining us. Suzie Cohen, give us one last word before we let you go back out into the wild.
Anyone who follows me on Twitter will know this one. I've been talking about it this morning, actually. Scurry funging. Scurry funging, old American dialect word for running around the house, shoving stuff into cupboards, kicking stuff under the bed because visitors are about to arrive. That's a scurry funge.
So that's another good one. And spelling on that on your Twitter feed, I think that's the way to do it.
Oh, yeah, that one's quite simple.
Yep. Thank you both for joining us.
Thanks,
Jason. Thank you, Jason.
Time for another tune from Angela Lewis Brown, this time All Along the Watchtower. Hey, yeah! There must be some kind of way out of here. Send the Joker to the feet. There's too much confusion. I can't get no relief. Businessmen, they drink my wine. Clamming, take my earth. No one level on my mind. Nobody up at his word. Hey, 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 hey. No reason to get excited. The feety Kelly spoke. There are many here among us who feel life is but a joke. You and I, we've been through that, and this is not our fate. So let us stop talking for tonight. The hour is getting late, late, late. Yeah. Princes kept their view, while all the women came and went, barefoot servants too. Lewis Brown with All Along the Watchtower, the second of the double A-side that's released on the 28th of February via Wobbly Music. Research shows that Brits appear to feel the pressure to spend money left them on important life choices, but those leaving the money want them to spend it on living their life. To tell us more about this survey, I'm joined now by Charles Offord, Managing Director of Co-op Insurance, and TV and music legend Martin Kemp. Hello to you both.
Hey, how are you? You okay?
All good here. Now, Interesting survey, this one. What do we spend effectively our inheritance on?
Yeah, I think it's a really interesting question. But I think the main thing is that you have that inheritance,
mm-hmm.
and that you know you have that choice what you spend it on.
Yeah, because I mean, none of us are getting any younger. That's the given. And I have a life insurance policy which covers the mortgage should I suddenly fall under a bus. But you know, there's going to be some cash left over. So what do you do with it? That's an important question.
Yeah, it's a funny thing that's come out of this research. You know, this co-op research, is that when we leave money to younger people, we kind of want them to enjoy themselves,
mm-hmm.
and make memories and maybe go on this great holiday, you know, and have a good time on us. The younger people that receive it, the people you're leaving it to, they actually want to invest it. And they want to put it, you know, it's hard enough to get on the property ladder as it is, isn't it? I mean, you know what you're just talking about.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, pay for a rent or, you know, get back on that, buy that house that you've always wanted. So, but what's come out of this, I think, is it's nice to have the choice.
Yeah, and it is about choosing. I mean, there's a chance to, you know, to leave a letter saying what you think you would like as well. I suppose, though, Martin, in your case, with Roman, you know, gadding off halfway around the world being paid to go on holiday, basically, even though it looked like no holiday at all, you've got to work out what the kids are going to do, haven't you?
Of course you do, you know, but it's something, it's a conversation, I think, that people have nowadays, is with what you're going to leave them and how what you're going to spend it on. I think when I grew up, those kind of conversations were really difficult. You know, but now people talk about everything. You talk about what music you want played at a funeral. You talk about your bucket list of stuff you want to do before you go. And I think it's talking about the money that's going to be left to you is what you're going to do with it.
And Charles, when people are putting together a sort of plan to make sure their funeral's covered, because that's obviously one concern, and then the rest of the immediate expenses, actually, you know, with a sensible policy, you for quite a small outlay each month, you can get something that's going to look after the family.
Yeah, that's exactly what it is. So there's two options here. You can either put money into a bank account, and our research is showing that a lot of people are having to go into that bank account to pay for things that happen in life. So mm-hmm. the boiler goes, or the you need a set of tyres on the car, or whatever. With our over 50s plan, you can put a few pounds away each month, and then when I pass away, I'll leave that as a nest egg for my family, and they can decide to do what they want with it. They can either go with my wishes and spend a bit of money and raise a drink to Dad, or they can use it for paying off their own debts or whatever. But it's, for me, being the dad, it just gives a little bit of comfort to me that I'll be able to be helping them at some point in their future.
Because it can be life insurance or life assurance, can't it? There's two different things there.
Yeah, so you talked earlier about the link to your mortgage. That's linked to a very specific event. So if you pass away, it will pay your mortgage off. That's over the term of your mortgage. This is more when you become over 50 and then you are paying into a savings plan, which then pays out upon your passing, and that pays a lump sum to your family.
And it's different for different people around the country as to what they're actually planning on doing with this as well. As people in Northern Ireland and Yorkshire are more likely to save the money rather than use it for family and fun when they get this.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, funny things come out of these researches, don't they? But if you ask me, I would say it's the same for everybody up and down the country. I mean, what we're trying to give people here is the choice, and that's the same for everyone.
But as you say, talk about it. Is it a sort of conversation you guys have had in your family?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I mean, my kids know exactly what I want after I go. It's a nice position to be able to leave things to your next of kin.
And yeah, DJ set from any of the family as well thrown in at the wake?
yeah, I'll get a few of those.
It's going to happen, isn't it?
But hopefully I'll get that for free.
Well, yeah, they won't stick it on the bill to the undertaker, because that could make pricey, yeah, couldn't it, to be fair?
That's right. Yeah, a little bit of Bluetooth coming in my coffin.
So you want a speaker in the coffin, and so you know, I'm not sure how it works, but it could be possible. You could be able to listen from the other side. Bluetooth may be that piece of magic that does it. But
Who knows?
Any of your own songs, though? Are you going to be having one that you've written or sung on performed at the...
Uh, don't want to talk about what
okay,
I'm doing.
Okay, we won't go there. We won't get
that's going to be a private thing.
Right, okay, it's worth a try. But, you know, it is all about talking about it, though. Yeah, whoever we are, whatever our background, it is vitally important you have that conversation, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Obviously, we want to be thinking about it, even though it is the unthinkable. So, Charles, where can we go for more information?
Just head on to the Co-op Insurance website and you'll find all the information on there.
In a sad time, hopefully having something there which can put a bit of joy and happiness into the family's lives.
Hey, that's what it's all about, isn't it? You know, it's a bit of joy and happiness. As I say, if my family can raise that glass to me, hey, that makes a difference for me.
That's a bit of joy and happiness, but it's also about a little bit of security as well, isn't it?
Yeah, and a mix of both will go down very well. Well, Charles Offord, Managing Director of Co-op Insurance, and Martin Kemp, thank you both for joining us.
Thanks a lot, man.
Great day. Thank you.
Bye.
So true, funny how it seems, always in time, but never in line for dreams. Head over heels, went toe to toe. This is the sound of my soul. This is the sound.
The Fallings Park Methodist Church and Community Centre in Wimborne Road, Fallings Park. Each Wednesday, they have a very special event taking place. To tell us more, I'm joined now by one of the leaders, Gillian Farley. Hello.
Hello.
Tell us a bit about your Luncheon Club.
Well, we meet on a Wednesday. Our members come really for a social occasion. Most of them are in their late 80s, 90s. Some of them are quite isolated. Many of them have got sight problems and other medical problems. They're picked up by, well, they're now National Express Assisted Travel, but better known as Ring and Ride. Mm-hmm. We have a block booking with them. They come to us. They have tea, coffee and biscuits when they arrive. Then there will be some sort of activity, a three-course lunch, which we cook on the premises, some other sort of activity after that, and then before they go home, cup of tea and a piece of cake. It is actually a social event for them. We're not a day centre or a care centre. We are actually a social occasion for them.
So we're really looking at relatively independent members of the community, but those who will need assistance from, as you say, what was known as Ring and Ride. And it all takes place between 10:15 and 2:30. So
That's correct. Each
Wednesday is a chance to get together. Now, it's for the older member of the community, but what sort of age range are we looking at available to?
Well, we have had younger members in the past because we take people who are really quite isolated.
Mm-hmm.
Many of them have got medical problems. We have got one or two who are unable to go out on their own. But basically, it is, like I say, it's a social occasion where they can come, they can interact with each other, they can have a chat, but also enjoy themselves. For example, every 2 weeks we have seated exercises, which they all enjoy, and then they enjoy things like we do bingo, craft activities, we have the occasional speaker, and anything really that encourages them to talk to each other and keep their minds active.
And it could be the best meal they'll have in a week as well, because you're providing a three-course meal with biscuits as a pre-starter.
Well, yes, definitely. Some of them are very good. They'll have their cup of coffee when they come in the morning or their cup of tea, and they resist the biscuits. But yes, a three-course meal, soup, main course and a dessert, and we try to make sure that it's nutritious. And you're right there. I think for some of them, it is actually the only hot meal they have in a week.
And it's difficult to do on scale sometimes as well. If you're cooking for one, it's really difficult to get the right size portions. If you're cooking for a group like this, you know you can have an enjoyable social time, something great to eat. And it's very much like a family affair.
Yes, very much, very much so. They're all very friendly. In fact, several of them during the week, they keep contact with each other, they phone each other. So it's like a lifeline, I think, for one or two of them.
Mm-hmm. And it sounds like an absolutely fantastic event to be part of. And I'm sure you and the team working on it must have a great time interacting with these people as well.
Oh, yes, we're all volunteers. We've got those that sort of prefer to stay in the kitchen and work in the kitchen. We've got others that are very good just sitting around and chatting to the members and, you know, sort of sharing what they've done in the week. But we're all volunteers. We're non-profit making. And because our numbers are low, that's our income, because we do obviously have to charge. We charge a £24 annual fee, which actually keeps us financially afloat. And then we charge £7 a week. And as I say, for that, they get everything that we offer, to be honest. But that's our income. So if we're only averaging about 11 members a week, our income at the moment is very low. We really need about 18 members to keep financially afloat. Mm-hmm. And we can't understand why we're not getting extra members, because there's obviously a need in the community for this, but yeah, people are not coming back to us, or we're not getting the referrals, basically, and we can't understand why.
Yep, so if you know somebody in the area who it would suit, we'd say we're looking at older members of the community, we're looking at people who may be a little bit isolated, a chance to get out and enjoy, and it's £7 plus the annual fee at £24. It's exceptionally good value for what you're getting as well, because it is a whole day event, and it could well be this is the only opportunity to get out in the week, as there's the small cost of the ring and ride to get there as well. But overall, you're looking at an exceptionally good value time, and the opportunity to do something different and socialise. So, you know,
that's right. Yes, that's correct.
And you're not using your own heating when you're there either, are you? So, you know, you've got it's a win-win situation.
Well, it is, and it's comfortable. I mean, the room is nice and warm. It's nice and comfortable. The chairs are actually comfortable as well. So we should have everything going for us, really.
That all helps. So if people want to come along, if it's an older member of the family that they think would benefit from it, or whether it's something that they're listening now and thinking, hang on, that is certainly something that fits in for me, can they talk to you first?
What we normally do is they contact either myself or Helen, and then we go together to visit the person who shows interest, and we talk to them, tell them exactly what we do to make sure that it is what they want. They can come along for perhaps just one occasion, and if they don't like it, obviously there's no pressure. Mm-hmm. But as yet, everybody who has come along has stayed with us until, unfortunately, the inevitable, and we've lost them. Mm-hmm. As I say, our numbers have dropped dramatically just lately, and we do need to make these numbers up if we're going to keep going.
Yep, certainly it's something that is serving the community exceptionally well, and it could just be they don't know about it. So, you know, this is what we need to publicise now. So if they want to get in touch, what do they do?
Contact either myself or Helen on our mobile numbers.
Right, so we're looking at 07979 418708. That is the number for Helen. 07979 418708, or it's Gillian on 07887 860 948. That's 07887 860 948, and have a bit of a chat, find out whether it is right for you, and be getting involved in the event, which is taking place, as you say, on Wednesdays, 10:15 through till 2:30. It's all down at the Fallings Park Methodist Church and Community Centre. That's on Wimborne Road in Fallings Park. So if you're in that sort of vicinity, can easily get there with the help of ring or ride, or if you've got access to other transport to get you down there, then certainly get involved. Enjoy the biscuits, the cake, and the three-course meal.
And us.
And, of course, the company too. What more could you ask for? Yes. It sounds absolutely fantastic. So keep up the good work. Fingers crossed the numbers get back up to where you need them to be. And you never know, there might be a waiting list before you know it.
Oh, that'd be lovely. Okay.
Gillian Farley, thanks again.
Right, thank you. Bye-bye.
That's a lot for this week. Thank you so much for joining us. Episode 556 next week. I'll see you then. Ta-ra for now.
Goodbye from the milk bar. 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 Yeah. Goodbye from the milk bar. Yeah.